Thanks everyone. Thanks for having me here to talk today. I'm going to talk about how we put some of the cheese on our hamburger at Ambulance Victoria. I think we did double cheese. So today I'm going to be talking about how we use technology to improve CPR performance, but I think the word I missed from the title was how we use technology to measure and then improve CPR performance. I'll start by telling you about mid to late 2017, we ran a CPR feedback pads trial at Ambulance Victoria, where we rolled out the feedback pads with our Zoll monitors to a number of branches and collected CPR performance from around 85 cases and analysed that CPR performance to see how our teams were going. And this is how our teams were performing with live feedback at the case. So it wasn't blinded or anything like that. What we found was we had average pre-shock pause time of around 16 seconds, and less than 20% of the time we were meeting both the rate and the depth targets. Rate between 100 and 120 and depth of 5 centimetres or more. And what we know about resuscitation is that the more and more we look into it is that it's actually CPR performance that makes a big difference on outcomes. Any of the other interventions that go on top of that, the ALS and intensive care stuff, if CPR is done poorly, the chance of that patient surviving is far decreased. And if CPR is done very well, the chance of your interventions being successful are greatly increased, and overall the chance of the patient gaining ROSC and surviving to discharge is greatly increased as well. What we did learn from it was that technology alone is not the answer. You can't just provide a device that gives feedback to crews and expect that they're going to do excellent CPR because the machine's saying so. That there's more that's needed. The whole rest of the burger, otherwise you're just eating cheese and it's not good for your cholesterol and your wife's giving you trouble for your cholesterol, etc. David mentioned that everyone thinks they're really good at CPR, and everyone probably assumes that everyone there in their organisation is excellent at CPR. We're the experts at out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. But if you're not measuring your organisation, your EMS CPR performance, then you really don't know how they're performing. But this is a study from the US where they tested CPR performance on a small number of paramedics and EMTs. And at first they wanted to know what's their perception of how they're doing at CPR. And it's not bad. Some of it's pretty modest, you know. I do my 50-50 cycle 75% of the time. I get depth, you know, about at least 80% of the time. Their actual performance tested on mannequins was far worse than what they expected, apart from hand position. Tell you what, we can get hand position, right? No worries. But the rest of it is what really makes a big difference in survival. So that was pretty much true for our organisation. No doubt we thought we were doing much better than we were, and if you're not measuring, you won't know either. So get out there and measure your CPR performance, and that way you'll be able to improve. What do we do with our information? We introduced a suite of changes. We introduced high-performance CPR and also some guideline changes that support the introduction of high-performance CPR. So Bridget went through and described some of the most integral sort of basic concepts of high-performance CPR, that is maximise CPR performance and high quality CPR, and essentially using communication and teamwork and choreography to minimise those interruptions to CPR. And that's as simple as it is. So what we did was we changed some of our guidelines. One of the biggest changes was going from a semi-automatic mode on the defibrillator to manual mode, which helped to reduce our pre-shock time. We had a training session with our paramedics and first responders and our fire first responders. We've introduced a new focus on high-quality CPR, sort of, again, brought it back to the basics and re-emphasised the importance of providing high-quality CPR and de-emphasising the importance of getting an early tube or getting an IV or IO and whatever else you want to do. Without that sort of foundation of high-quality CPR, the rest of it's sort of just for show. We introduced feedback via the feedback pads, and we introduced a model where people at the scene and the team leader at the scene can monitor feedback and ensure that crews are responding to that monitor. We've turned on the metronome as well to keep the rate in check. In our guideline, we decided to delay mechanical CPR rather than have it come on any time early in the resuscitation. We found that around 90 to 95% of our patients who get ROSC do so in the first 12 to 14 minutes of the arrest. So we don't want to interrupt high-quality manual CPR in those first critical minutes. to put on a device, even though we know it does great CPR. If we interrupt CPR early in the arrest, we may never get ROSC, and it's, you know, a bit of a catch-22 putting it on. We introduced the team leader role. We introduced a choreography that can be followed. We brought in a checklist. We've introduced debriefing, which is evidence-based, recommended by the AHA, and shown to improve resuscitation care for individuals and teams and improve outcomes. And as I mentioned, the one of the big changes to that has improved our compression fraction and time to pre-shock is that change from semi-automatic mode back to manual defib. So there's a number of ways that we are using the technology, hopefully to improve CPR performance. So during the actual attempt, resuscitation attempt, we've got real-time feedback. So we use this device with the little puck that goes on the chest, and that tells the paramedics exactly how they're doing CPR. It provides information on the rate, provides information on the depth, and information on the recoil. And with the metronome there, it aids in getting the rate right. So we use that device in simulation, so in training, and also at live resuscitation events. Post-event, so we can analyse the information. You can push that information up to the cloud and then retrieve that at a later time and have a look at the CPR performance from that case. So one of the ways that we're using that technology is that we're using it to inform our debrief report. So we're having a look at the essentially an overview of the case, and then how did the crew perform CPR? Was it high quality? Was there room for improvement? There's always room for improvement, but focusing on where the biggest gains are potentially made there. What's important with debriefing is that it needs to remain non-punitive. You don't want people to become defensive or be concerned about having deficiencies highlighted. You want it to be a quality improvement initiative. You want people to want to know how they went. And people to, part of instilling that culture of excellence is that people want to know how they're performing and they want to be able to improve upon their own performance and get better. And as everyone does that, soon the organisation will be lifting up. It's a quality improvement initiative. Here's an example of some of the data that we can get from our monitor that provides, this is a real case that happened early last week. Some of the data, each one of those bars in the second row there is a compression. You can see the person's second on compressions, they were too shallow. And their rate, the third column, the third row down, was too fast. You know, so part of the feedback, you won't say, oh, whoever was second on compressions, you need to get out and do some training. But it's a team responsibility to provide high quality CPR. And something that would be highlighted in this debrief report is there was a cycle where CPR was done too fast and too shallow. And there's a correlation between that. You know, it just so happens that if you're doing CPR at a rate of about 120, you're also able to reach the depth of at least 5 centimetres. The faster you go, the harder it is to achieve an adequate depth, and the harder it is to achieve adequate recoil. So it all sort of fits together. You want it to sort of run effortlessly, like a ballet, you know. It all has to work together. And that's some of the information we feed back to crews. We're also using the technology to inform education. So David also mentioned that we everything that we do, we want it to be evidence-based. We don't want someone to sort of say, oh, I saw this the other week and I thought it was pretty good, so I'm going to roll that out. We're using evidence to inform all of our decisions and to inform our education. So we're able to look at our CPR performance, and we're also, during the debriefing process, we're able to collect trends on what's happening out there. And find out where there's room for improvement in our CPR performance and in our resuscitation practice in general. So since introducing the feedback pads and introducing high-performance CPR in February, we've been able to measure and see where there's room for improvement. One of the big changes was with regards to the introduction of see-through CPR, some of the technology that we can use with our monitors. We had crews had a slight misunderstanding of the technology, and they were jumping to defibrillating rhythms without an adequate time allowed for a rhythm check during the pause. And we were able to identify that quickly, and we responded to it with education packages, and we've brought it back. And that's something that we were only able to do because we were looking at cases and looking at data post-event. Otherwise, practice would be going on, all we'd be doing is reading the case sheet, and as you read a case sheet, you know, the cases all go very well when you read the case sheet and don't have anything else to measure. So we're able to adjust our pre-shock pause time and have them to an appropriate, very short but acceptable length of time that you can accurately measure the underlying rhythm. We've also found that because end-tide or CO2 is a relatively new tool that we've introduced at the ALS paramedic level, so we've introduced the device that we use with the supraglottic airway. We put it on early in cardiac arrest, but what we were finding was crews are attaching it to the supraglottic airway, they're plugging it into the monitor, and then there's a delay before they actually press the button to initiate it. And so that's something we were able to pick up in our debriefing as well. You can tell that the end-tide is attached, they haven't then gone to the next step of press the button, so we've introduced it into our education. And so we're able to inform that because we can see it's a trend that's going on. Some of the examples of how it can inform education and practice change. Karen spoke about our cardiac arrest registry with almost 100,000 or more than 100,000 cases of cardiac arrest in there now. And since February, when we introduced our feedback pads and we've been able to collect CPR performance data, we're actually starting to contribute that into our registry and their new fields that we're collecting. So it's going to be a very long time before we have enough data to be able to draw on and tell how our CPR performance is actually impacting outcomes rather than sort of making straight assumptions. We'll be able to compare CPR performance looking at specific measures and compare that with VACR outcomes, which is the potential for future research there is massive. And I don't know if there's many other places that include CPR performance in a registry like that. And it's a really exciting time. So I wonder if any of this has had any impact. If putting the cheese on was worth it, or putting double cheese on was worth it. This is a measure of looking at our CPR performance back when we did our CPR feedback pads trial. And some of those results didn't sound particularly impressive. You know, 16 second pre-shock pause time, about 20% of the time getting our target measures. It doesn't sound very impressive, but that was a year when we had 39% Ulstein survival. So if we improve upon that CPR performance, what impact is that going to have? Yellow is our pre-high performance CPR introduction, and there you go. So now we're meeting the depth target ranges at 58% of the time. We've almost come close to doubling the amount of time we're within the rate range. So our actual values, our average values of depth and rate haven't changed very much, but we're in those targets for a greater percentage of time during that cardiac arrest, and that's what really counts. You don't want to do CPR at a rate of 200 for half the arrest and a rate of 10 for the other half of arrest and cheer when you get an average rate of 110. You want to be in that range the whole time. Our pre-shock pause time, the sample that I took was 11 seconds. We know it was worse over the entire period, but that's come right down to about 2.4 seconds. And this is from a small sample, but it's been actually consistent over about 180 cases we've looked at from February and March. We've maintained these good numbers. Chest compression fraction, you know, for every percent, it roughly equates to about a 1% increase in survival. So we've gone from an average of 82%, and it's now up to 94% with our change. So introducing something like high performance CPR, we all know that it's going to have a good impact. We know it is, the evidence is there, but we've actually been able to measure what impact it's had on CPR performance because we've got the tools and we're using the technology. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for having me up for the opportunity. And I thought I'd leave it with a joke because I'm can't take anything too seriously. Thank you.